Today, as promised, we are designing the optimized antenna, and I'm really looking forward to the results of the first tests. In the last episode, we were showing the principle how the inventor computed the special shape of this antenna. A fascinating process. We tried this method ourselves and we actually found the shape for the maximum directivity by optimizing the pitch angles of the antenna segments. You are welcome to watch the earlier video on Electronics Unmasked, where we demonstrated it using the program Coconec. Looking at the solution for the maximum directivity, we are not yet understanding why exactly this shape is the result. The matter is actually a bit complicated, but I'll try to give a simple explanation anyway. If we look at the current distribution on the antenna, we find three current maxima. For our simplified model of thought, we assume that these are the sources of radiated electromagnetic waves. The currents are phased unfavorable, which is why several radiation lobes are formed as long as the rods are straight. The spatial shape shifts the phases so that the electromagnetic waves superimpose in the main beam direction. We can say that the spatial shape is shifting the phase of the radiated waves for the maximum directivity. Our calculation with Coconec produced these angles after 59 iterations. Each iteration includes approximately 20 neck calculations. That means we had to call neck more than 1000 times to achieve this result. But okay, the computer doesn't complain. We found 7 dBi directivity to be the optimum. In the right column, we have the angle increments that the optimization procedure varied in the last step. I'm checking the increments to see whether the procedure has reached its optimum actually. Originally, the length of the antenna was 1.5 lambda, but I shortened it a little in order to achieve a non-reactive impedance. For our first test setup, I chose the Wi-Fi frequency of 2.45 GHz. At that frequency, the antenna dimensions are relatively small, and I'm having a lot of Wi-Fi devices around me to carry out tests under real conditions. Later, I will certainly calculate the design for other radio services that are interesting for amateurs and makers. I'm using a spreadsheet in order to calculate X and Y coordinates from the pitch angles, as these are easier to handle when designing the antenna. Furthermore, it's allowing me to scale the antenna for different frequencies and to create a graphic that I can use as a template for the curved shape. I'm just creating a mirror of the image, then put the two images together, and at the end I'm bringing it to the right size so that I get a one-to-one scaled template for the antenna. Now we need to talk about the impedance of the antenna, which by the way fluctuates a bit while optimizing the shape. In the end, we get the set non-reactive impedance. Since our Smith chart is normalized to 50 ohms, the value 2 corresponds to an impedance of 100 ohms. So we need a matching network that transforms the antenna impedance from 100 ohms to 50 ohms. NEC computes the antenna impedance approximately only. Possibly the actual impedance will deviate slightly from this value. But still, this gives us a good starting point to design an antenna matching network. We've shown in earlier videos how to build an impedance matching network. We developed a small tool for this that is offering several solutions. You could use a simple quarter wave transformer, which I calculated here. However, I'm preferring the following solution, even when it is a bit more complex. So let's take a step back. We also use a quarter wavelength waveguide, however with a short at the end. Our 50 ohms cable is then connected to a specific point along the waveguide. The advantage of this solution is that the short prevents static discharge from damaging our electronics and also filters out low frequencies that could interfere. We are using our proven tool to calculate the waveguide's impedance needed and the position of the feed. The required impedance is 48.6 ohms and the feed point's distance to the short is 15.3 millimeters. I thought it would be nice having a 3D printed framework for the antenna. And off we go with FreeCAD. I use the so-called spline function because you can use it to create practically any shape. First, I'm creating a path using my calculated x and y coordinates, and then the set spline function gives us a continuous line using these points. Next, I'm defining a cross section using a rectangle. And finally, I'm creating the shape using the so-called sweep function. The rest is very simple. A mirrored copy of the part completes the antenna frame, and then I'm adding a cuboid that will carry the antenna matching network. The waveguide we will realize using two plates that we put onto the cuboid. The size of the cuboid results from the following calculation. I haven't mentioned it yet. I added the two-plate waveguide to the Excel tool, which is helping us to dimension it for an impedance of 48.6 ohms. I'm estimating the value of about 2 for the relative permittivity of my PLA material, which corresponds to a filling level of about 50%. In case you are interested, we had a previous video on the channel about a 3D printed loop antenna where we explained the relation between permittivity and fill level. Okay, our 3D printed frame for the antenna will look like this. And now we are adding the actual antenna plus its matching network from conductive material. Through that hole, we will later connect an SMA connector or a coax cable. Okay, now we need to print the frame and then we will assemble the antenna. I'm excited about the practical setup and our measurements. In case my trial will be successful, I will certainly dimension the antenna for other services such as amateur radio, mobile communication, Bluetooth, LoRa, DMR, TV, radio, etc. So, more on the topic soon on this channel. Now, stay tuned and don't forget to support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.